Hello everyone, welcome to this episode on Unity Dots. Today, we will learn more about the Unity Physics Package. We will scan our surroundings to react to nearby entities using the Overlap Sphere method and discover the closest heat collector. And if you stick to the end of the video, you will also learn about the Component Lookup concept. This concept will allow us to interact with other entities to implement simple combat mechanics. You can get the starter project for this video in the GitHub linked in the description. The only thing missing will be the skeleton model, but you can get it for free in the asset store. And you can check out my other videos to learn how we made this starter project from zero. By the end of this video, you will be one step closer to a tower defense prototype, as you can see on screen. Now, let's dive into it. The first thing we want to do is to prevent the user from placing two towers in the same place. To do that, in our input system, before placing the tower, we will check that there is not already a tower at the same place. That can be done using an overlap sphere. Unlike a recast that finds entities in a single direction, the overlap sphere will look for all entities within a fixed sphere. It must not be confused with a sphere cast. Sphere cast, like a recast, is moving in a single direction and will gather entities along its path. But instead of the line of the recast, it will use a sphere, making a larger path. The overlap sphere doesn't move. It checks its surroundings in all directions. We can use it to make sure there isn't anything where we want to place our tower. Using the physics world, call the overlap sphere method. Provided the position where the tower would be, adding some margin not to be on the terrain. Then, the radius of the sphere. 0.1 will be enough for it to overlap with the tower. For the list of hits, we will need to declare a native list. This is one of the native containers that are compatible with Burst and thread-safe to use in jobs. For now, we don't really use it, so we can just consider it as a normal list. We will explore native containers in another video. Finally, for the collision filter, you can use the default filter as we want to check if anything is in the place of the future tower. The method returns a bool, so we can just wrap our tower spawning logic in an if statement. If we head back to Unity and enter play mode, you will see that we can't place two towers at the same place. But we can make a tower of towers. That's because all our physics is using the default filter layers. So everything collides with everything, including the recast to get the terrain position and the tower. To fix that, we can create a physics category names asset to define collision layers. We can name one input, another terrain, and a third tower. Let's also make an enemy and projectile layer for later in the video. Last thing to do, parameterize our recast that is hard-coded with the default filter. In the player manager, add two physics category tags, one called belongs to and another called collides with. Assign their value to override the default filter, then save your file and test it in Unity. Set the player manager to belong to the input layer and collide with the terrain layer. Now assign the layers to the objects using a physics shape autolink component instead of the colliders and body. And the tower to belong to the tower layer and collide only with the tower layer. As you can see, we can now place towers on the terrain without the risk of placing multiple towers in the same spot or one on another. Now, what I want is for the tower to find the closest enemy and fire a projectile at it. The logic to spawn a projectile is very similar to the one used to spawn our enemies, so I won't go over the details again. If you want more detailed explanation, you can check the video where we spawned our enemies. You can just grab the GitHub gist in the description and paste it in your project to get all the code. It's also a good time for you to hit the like button if you enjoyed learning with my videos. It shows me the content is appreciated and motivates me to continue this journey. This also helps the YouTube algorithm know this content is worth sharing with others. So thank you for your like. Once the gist is in your project, you can dispatch its content into separate files. After that, you can set up the autolink components you just imported on the game objects. Create a sphere prefab for our projectile and add the projectile autolink component, a shape, and a body to it. In each tower prefab, add an empty above the tower and assign it the tower autolink component. The enemy will also need a new damageable autolink component. Now, if you enter play mode and make a tower, you will see the tower spawns a projectile. But the projectile doesn't do anything. To make it go towards an enemy, we must first find the closest one. We will again use an overlap sphere, but this time we will use it with the closest hit collector to get the closest entity. That will be our target enemy. We can store a reference to the target enemy on the projectile. To make our projectile follow the target, we can make another for each loop that will make the projectile move forward. For the projectile forward vector to point towards the target entity, we will need the target position. But since we are iterating over the projectiles, not the enemy, we don't have access to it. To get the target entity position, we will need to use a component lookup. The component lookup provides a way to get the component data for a specific entity. It is less performant than the for each iteration as it can access any arbitrary entity, so avoid using it to iterate over data. Despite the random memory access it implies, it is the best solution when it comes to implement entity interactions. You can create the component lookup in onCreate with the true flag to mark it read-only, and update it outside the for each before using it as an array. We can also check if the entity still has the expected component. For instance, if our enemy has been destroyed, we won't be able to get its position, and the projectile will have nowhere to go, so we can destroy it. Going back to the editor, after setting the collision layers on the enemy, you should now see your projectile move towards the closest enemy at the time it was created. We can use another component lookup on the else component to deal damage to our enemy. Use the false parameter value to mark it as read and write. Now, in a for each, iterate over all projectile, and if it's near the enemy, destroy it and reduce the enemy health. To write to a component using a component lookup, you will need first to make a local variable of the component, modify it, and assign it back to the lookup. This is because the components are value types and they are not written by reference. So when you get a component from the lookup, what you get is a copy of the component, not the actual component itself. Finally, we can check if the new else is below zero and destroy the enemy if it is. Go back to Unity and start killing your enemies by placing defense towers. We used a simple distance check to know when our projectile hits our target. This is fine because we know between which entities to check the distance. If we were to make a piercing projectile, we would not know that since it could hit any number of targets. And iterating over all enemies to check the distance between each one isn't ideal. So for the next video, we will see how trigger events works. This will also be the opportunity to introduce the job concept. In the meantime, hit the like button and share this video with anyone learning Dots. If you have a question or feedback, leave a message in the comment section or on Discord. See you in the next video!